Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading is from 2 Samuel, chapter 1, verse 1, 17 through 27. After the death of Saul, David had returned from defeating the Amalekites. David remained 2 days in Ziklag. David intoned a lamentation over Saul and his son, Jonathan. He ordered that the song of the bow be taught to the people of Judea. It is written in the book of Shemar. He said, "Your glory, O Israel, lies slain upon your high places. How the mighty have fallen. Tell it not in that, proclaim it not in the streets of Ashkelon. For the daughters of the Philistines will rejoice. The daughters of the uncircumcised will exult. Do not ask the Lord, let there be no dew or rain upon you, your bounteous fields. For there the shield of the mighty will survive, the shield of Saul anointed with oil no more. From the blood of the slain and the fat of the mighty, the vow of Jonathan did not turn back when the sword of Saul returned empty. Saul and Jonathan, beloved in life and death, they were not divided. They were swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. O daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you with crimson and luxury, who put ornaments of gold on your apparel. How the mighty have fallen in the midst of the battle. Jonathan and I slain upon your high places. I am distressed for you. My brother Jonathan will greatly welcome you to me. Your love to me was wonderful as the passing, the love of God. How mighty have fallen, and the weapons of war perished." Our psalm today is Psalm 130, found on page 713 in the hymnal. Please join me in the refrain. At the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication.
I place all my trust in you, my God.
O immediately turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you said, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had been done to her, came in fear and trembling, and fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any farther?" But ignoring what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. When they had come to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, he saw a tumult and people weeping and wailing.
stand on it and trust it, even in the process. Let me give you a personal example. I remember the day the doctor sat down with me and told me I had aggressive cancer. And I said, I shall live and not die. Now, you do your part. I'm going to do my part. My part is faithfully reading and speaking, putting it out there into the atmosphere. I shall live and not die. And I'm going to go on as I have been going on. And I'm going to declare the word of God that you're not taking me out. Not yet. Amen.
Amen.
Sometimes you have to come back at whatever is troubling you with an attitude that's almost like anger. You got to be very adamant. I am not leaving. I am not being defeated. I am not turning back. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter the process that I have to go through. God, you got me this far. You'll get me to the other side of the process. I just have to have the faith to, quote unquote, as we say, hang in there. Amen?
Yeah.
And listen, it's for the believer. It's not for the pastor, the bishop, you know, the somebody that you put a title and a name to. It's for the believer. It could be the church now. You know what I'm saying? Don't take your walk of faith and belittle. Don't take your walk of faith into the life of that child. The child didn't understand. But God wasn't answering their understanding. He was answering your faith for your child to be up the next morning. The young woman that went and touched Christ is gone. I can only imagine her saying, this may be the only time in my life that I might see this man in person. Think now, Jesus didn't stay in the same spot too long, right? He, and everywhere he went, he walked, so he had to move. If he wanted to get out to the people, it wasn't like he could go get in the car or take the bus or take the train. So there was a great possibility if she didn't step up in that moment, she may never get the chance again to touch the hem of his garment. Even though she knew that there would be healing. Then, as soon as she touched the hem of his garment, and she felt the change within herself, she became immediately fearful. You want to know why? Because in that day, if you were a woman that was energy, you were considered filthy. You were isolated from society. You didn't go outside. You know, the neighbors didn't come to her. She was standing in a crowd. Number one, she went according to their culture. She wasn't supposed to be in the crowd in the first place. But sometimes you got to break the rules. Thank you, Jesus. When you need something from the Lord, you can't go by what the world is saying always. You have to have that relationship, you and Him. Father, I need you now like never before to pull me out of this hole. Father, I need your help with this. Father, take care of my kids. Amen. Same prayer I prayed this morning. Lord, take care of me until I get back home. Phone under the pulpit on silent for emergencies. You know what I'm saying? But I pray and I expect them to get home safely. I even expect them to come to the picnic this afternoon. I expect them to get out past here to get there unless they come really late. And I just got my little text this morning. Hey, that's when it starts. This is where it's at. If you're coming this way about that time, stop it, you know? Because you got to attract. You got to be inclusive. You got to love your young people and your old people and everybody in between. You got to love that sandwich generation. Listen, in my experience as a human being, the sandwich generation be more loving and caring than most of the rest of the population. Let me tell you why. The sandwich generation is families that are families. They have children. And now they're taking care of mom, daddy, grandparent, uncle, whatever, whomever. An elderly person in the home. Okay? So there you got three generations you're dealing with. That's three sets of social values, isn't it? And so, if you're not running for this one, to take them to the sports field for this, that, and the other, then you're running for the elder person to the doctor's office or to the hospital or, you know? And so, we need to know our people, just like I want to know you. I want to know all of you. I want to know how you do. I want to know about your family. And granted, I'm new, and you're probably saying, well, that's not my business, and she doesn't have a clue. but you can never get away from God. Or Christ. Or the Holy Spirit. It will be wherever you go, it will follow you after. And sometimes it's been my experience that he goes first and meets you when you get there. You just don't know he's going to do what he's going to do. Amen? Have faith. Trust him. And don't do this one thing, and I will be about to finish. I've seen people pray, but they turn around and try to tell God how to do what they prayed for. He doesn't need you. If you could have done it, you could have done it on your own. When you give it to him, you're giving it to the one who has all power, he's everywhere, he knows everything. Why would you want him to reduce that greatness to the size of your mind? That would make him able to function only as a human being. He couldn't be the God that we reach you to. And we have to understand that. Let him be God. He might choose to fix it somewhere else, and then you just end up with the answer. He might bring things into your life or people into your life that you would never have thought. And I can say this with assurance that God uses dumbfounded words. He uses the one that many people would look at and go, not that, they couldn't do thus or so. You don't have a clue what God put inside of somebody else. And in many instances, we don't have a clue what he put inside of us unless we have a relationship with him. And he begins to pour it out and let you know what's going on. You can do awesome things. This church could do awesome things. You can move awesomely in the community, in the state, in the country, in the world. But you've got to keep that connection because it's not about who you are. It's about a walk of faith to a God who is able, who will protect you, provide for you, teach you, and hold you up while you're trying to do it. Amen?
Amen.
God loves each and every one of us, and he doesn't love any one of us in this room any less than the other person. He knows our personality, and he gets along with us based on what we're like. Amen. And when we look at it as human beings, we look at it as, oh God, I did this thing and that thing. He's looking based on who the person is, the created person is. He knows what it takes to get through her, or him, or me, or him, or you. He knows what it takes. And the words he might use for me might not be the same words he would use for you. Because they were making different things to us. I pray that we get hold of the word and are able to use it to the glory of God and to our advantage. And be disciples of Christ. What do I mean by that? He used it everywhere he went. And he would go away sometimes. personal relationship with the Lord. And you will most often be like that young woman. She got what she needed when she needed it. And she had tried every earthly person that she was able to reach. He talked about the doctors, all the doctors he'd gone to. She used up all of her finances. And you know how to know when you go to the doctor, they want their money, right? So think about that. Your faith may God will open doors. And you just have to walk through it.
reminder that next week we're going to be meeting downstairs in Palmer Hall. Same time, same building. But again, that's just a tradition that goes back almost 200 years to keep things a little bit cooler in the summer because it is nice and cool downstairs. It'll be an informal service, but we're still going to have a service, and that'll be the whole month of July. So we look forward to seeing everybody downstairs 10 o'clock next week.
Amen. Amen.